there's a couple more things I wanted to say about QCD and then move on to the parton model. Let's start with the strong coupling constant itself. So we talked about this potential, and we want to know how big the strong coupling constant is. And that only really makes sense to the extent that QCD is a perturbative theory. So the easiest way to measure it is through annihilation. So if you consider electron-positron annihilation, say into muons, so this is through a photon or a Z, the cross-section for this is 4 pi Lefine structure constant squared over 3 times the center of mass energy squared. And it's called a sigma naught. So this is something you can measure. You just scatter some electrons and see how many muons you get out. You can also scatter electrons and see how many hadrons you get out. And the idea is here is that you do, well, E plus E minus two quarks. And then something happens to the quarks after you produce them. But again, we're assuming we can factorize the production of quarks into the decay, and I can calculate the rate for quarks. And whenever I get hadrons, at short distance I was producing quarks, and then something happened to them. And so the thing I calculate is this, and the thing I measure is this, and this is going to be proportional to, well, a leading order, it's if this is just a photon, this is proportional to the same cross-section times the electric charge of the quarks. So this is sigma naught times so 2/3 for the up quarks squared. So we get a factor of q here, the quark charge. We square it because we square the amplitude, times 3 colors plus 1/3. Well, let's say this 3 is from, say we're doing this at very high energy, for example, that at LEP. You know, this corresponds to the up. Okay, this is just three, these are flavors. And then the downtype quarks, we might also have 3 flavors, depending on how high energy we do, and then we multiply by 3 colors. Anyway, this is just some number, so if we're lower energy, maybe we wouldn't sum over the top quark. Maybe a very low energy wouldn't sum over to the bottom quark. But in any case, this is just some result for the tree level cross section. So then we talk about this quantity R for the photon, R hadron, which is E plus E minus to gamma to hadrons divided by muons. So from this quantity, one nice thing about taking this ratio is that we don't really care about the initial state. So one thing that's confusing about colliders in general is you don't know necessarily the luminosity, you don't know how big the, what the exact energy is of the initial state. But when you take the ratio, a lot of those uncertainties drop out. So this ratio is something that you can calculate in perturbation theory that really only depends on the final state. So this ratio is the sum over colors and the sum over quarks. Maybe we sum from up to bottom times the charge. And if you do this sum, you get around 3.67. You can do the same calculation for exchange of a Z boson. In fact, if we include everything, the Z and the photon, the calculation gives 20.09. And again, this isn't just tree level. And then we measured this at LEP, and we found 20.79. Okay? And so the difference between these quantities, which is, a couple of percent, we can understand as due to loop corrections that exist in for this. So if the loops were the same for this and this, they would cancel in the ratio. But if you have loops that are relevant when you have quarks that aren't relevant when you have muons, they don't cancel. And those loops are, of course, the ones involving gluons. So we want to be we want to know what the calculation is for let me say this is zero tree level. We want to be able to calculate this ratio at next to leading order, and that's a very interesting calculation in QCD. And of course, we're not going to do the details, but let me just kind of summarize what goes into it. So the next leading order, we can emit a gluon off of either leg. And we want to sum these and square it, and then integrate it over phase space. And what do we get? We get R times sigma naught times CF 4 alpha S over pi times some quantity. So I'm going to do the calculation in dimensional regularization. We get a double pole. So here we're in D is 4 minus 2, 4 minus epsilon dimensions. These are tree-level emission graphs in a phase-space integral, so it's not divergent in the UV because there's nothing high energy about this. This is at fixed energy. So these 1 over epsilon squared poles are infrared divergences having to do with low energy, and the 1 over epsilon squared comes from the collinear limit of when the gluon is collinear to one of the quarks, or the soft limit when the gluon is very soft. And we'll understand this more in detail later. The point is, if you do this calculation, you get infinity as epsilon goes to zero, because you've only done half the calculation. And there's another contribution from different processes, which are, if we calculate this loop, times the tree level. So here we have a G here, and we square it, and we get something of order alpha. And here we have two Gs, so we have to multiply it by interference with the tree level to get something of order alpha. And if you calculate this, you get R sigma naught 4 alpha S over pi CF times mu squared over Q squared. This is to the 4 minus D CF times minus 1 over epsilon squared minus 13 over 12 epsilon. So we see that when you sum the real emission graphs in D dimensions with the virtual graphs, the 1 over epsilon squared poles and the 1 over epsilon poles both exactly cancel. Also, this 5 pi squared over 24 term cancels, which we couldn't have predicted ahead of time, and then you just get some number. So then the prediction is that the next leading order cross-section, which is the leading order plus real plus virtual, is the tree level times sigma naught times 1 plus alpha s 3 over alpha s over 4 pi CF, which is just 1 plus alpha s over pi. So what you get is there's a next leading order correction to the hadronic cross-section given by alpha s over pi, and then by comparing these two numbers, if we take this and we multiply 1 plus alpha s over pi, and it should equal that, we can solve for alpha s, and you get alpha s is around 0.11. So in order to have the total hadronic cross-section produced from E plus E minus colliders agree with experiment, we need to include the next leading order. In fact, you really need to get the next to next to leading order correction included. But we see that there's sensitivity to alpha s, and we can extract this just from measuring how many hadrons are produced compared to how many leptons at E plus E minus collider. The reason I wanted to put in these details, this is a very important calculation, and I think it's something that everyone should do at some point, because it really lets you appreciate some aspects of quantum field theory that you don't see from just doing other kinds of calculations. In particular, it's really remarkable that there's two different processes. Remember, this is electron positron to three particles, quark, quark, and gluon, and this is electron positron to two quarks. So you have to sum different processes to see the infrared divergences cancel. This is different from UV divergences. UV divergences is just one particular process. The UV divergences cancel at the amplitude level when you renormalize. This has nothing to do with renormalization. There's no UV divergence, but you have to add different kinds of final states. It has to be inclusive over all the final states. And that's closely related to the fact that the measurement is E plus E minus the hadrons, which doesn't distinguish between whether there were two quarks or two quarks and a gluon at the parton level, because that's not even a well-defined quantity. The infrared divergence is associated with not being able to distinguish experimentally a quark from a quark and a gluon, and therefore I have to sum these two processes in order to get a finite answer. Infrared divergences are somewhat unsatisfying in that sense, that they don't cancel at the amplitude level, they only cancel at the cross-section level. But they're also, it's also kind of amazing that they do cancel and you can calculate these quantities. It's also worth checking that it's regulator independent, that you see this cancels in dimensional regularization, but if you try it with a different regulator. So in my book, I do this calculation two ways in ThimReg and also with a Pauli-Villars regulator. And you see that you get the same factor of alpha s over pi with different regulators, which is also satisfying. Anyway, we'll come back to this, the origin of these infrared singularities later. Well, maybe we won't, but are there questions about this? I think this is the most straightforward way to see from data. This is just some number you can look up on the particle data group or look at the total cross-section measured and just do the theory calculation and figure out for yourself that there has to be a strong coupling constant and it's roughly 0.1. It's kind of the cleanest way to see what alpha s is. You know, there's other ways of extracting alpha s from the lattice and so on, but those are very hard to understand unless you're an expert. This is something that you just need elementary quantum field theory to do, although the calculations are, you know, a couple of pages and working out the details. The self energy? So when we calculate a cross section, we generally calculate amputated graphs. So from the LSE reduction theorem, we talk about the renormalization of the external legs coming in to cancel the poles in the propagator. So we don't include those when we calculate cross sections. So they are relevant to things like the running coupling, but they're not relevant to cross section calculations. There we use amputated graphs. So I don't know if you've ever done this calculation, but it's really worth doing. I mean, it might take you a day. It's an exercise that'll really make very real what's going on here in a way that I think is important to have. I was going to talk a little bit more about the running coupling. Let me not calculate it. Have all of you calculated the beta function in QCD at some point? Yeah. Yes. Right, but at fixed order and perturbation theory, there's no problem, right? We're not telling you we're trying to. It's a good question. You might say, well, in the limit where this is small, the appropriate value of alpha is something having to do with that collinear scale, but that's not the right way to think about it. We're measuring something inclusive, so we're measuring the total cross section. There's only one scale in the final result, which is the E plus E minus the hadrons cross-section. There's only one scale Q, the center of mass energy. So the only scale that has to be relevant to evaluate this is alpha s at that scale. That is, the cancellation here happens for any value of alpha because it happens perturbatively in G. So when you talk about inclusive quantities, you should only talk about what I'm gonna say. So if you want to include the running coupling, you can include, you know, vacuum polarization contributions to this. I can include loops for the photon, and that would come in a next leading order. And you can see that those loops that have to do with the running coupling, which would make it strong, come in not at this order, but of order, you know, alpha squared times log of mu over q. So you can see directly from the perturbative calculation that the relevant scale is q, because that's the scale you would choose to cancel the large logarithms of mu over q in this ratio. So you can see it directly from the calculation that the right scale is. But basically, this is a statement order by order in perturbation theory that the right scale is. And in fact, this log is what tells you that the scale at which we're evaluating alpha s in this calculation is q. It's because you choose mu equals q in MS bar to remove the large logarithm. Otherwise, your perturbation theory wouldn't work. The calculation kind of tells you that perturbation theory is okay at those scales. Other questions? Let me see if I... let me show this. Let's see if this works. Yeah, so this is measurements of alpha s from CMS, from doing these kind of ratios. These are various cross sections that are produced, and a comparison to predictions from QCD for alpha s. And you can see, a comparison to what CMS gets, which is essentially these three jet quantities in red and yellow, in comparison to the world average, which is black. So you see, just from CMS alone, you get very good agreement with other calculations. And you can see other, there's Hera on there as well. And actually, I suppose CMS are these black dots down there. And there's a bunch of other experiments at different center mass energies. And they're all perfectly consistent with this alpha s, with this Q scale dependence, which I'm not going to go through the calculation here, but let me just... remind you of the I was going to talk about this for 10 or 20 minutes, but I won't. I'll just summarize the answer in the interest of time. Right, so we talk about the beta function is the scale dependence of the normalized coupling in QCD, which is given by minus so this is the QCD beta function, which is and in other words, mu d by d mu of alpha minus alpha squared over 2 pi beta 0, where the leading order beta function coefficient is 11 minus 2/3 nf. And so this beta function is positive. So beta naught is greater than 0 for nf less than 17. So as long as we have less than 17 flavors, and we have, you know, 5 or 6, the beta function is positive, meaning that the coupling constant. So if this is a positive number, that means that as I increase mu, it gets smaller. So the coupling constant gets weaker at higher energy, which is qualitatively how QCD works. We can solve this equation for alpha, and we get alpha is 2 pi over beta naught, 1 over logarithm of mu over lambda QCD, where we're trading alpha at a particular scale for a dimensionful scale lambda QCD. Lambda QCD is around 100 MeV, depending on what scheme you're in. So this thing, this running value of the coupling is consistent with these plots, which, let's put them back on. Just, All right, so what I want to show. This one. Yeah, so this is different values of alpha S extraction at different scales from tau decays, lattice, deep and elastic scattering. The circle is what we just talked about, E plus E minus jets and shapes. Well, really E plus E minus total cross-section, which is related. And you see everything is consistent with this scale dependence given by perturbative QCD. And again, it's also consistent with these total cross-section measurements from colliders. Here's a kind of a summary of the world average from different values. So what the convention is to run everything up to the z-pole, somewhere where we know alpha is small. You see the smallest uncertainties come from lattice measurements and tau decays. And part of the reason the uncertainty is small is because when you're measuring alpha when it's big, a larger uncertainty runs to a smaller uncertainty at the z-pole, while you need a smaller uncertainty experimentally to begin with if you're doing z-pole observables. But anyway, these things they're roughly consistent. There's a little bit of a conflict between some of the lattice and the tau measurements, and also some of the E plus E minus measurements, but it's work in progress. But roughly, you should think about alpha S as being around 0.1 with around 1% uncertainty. If you haven't done this calculation, it's worth doing, and it's important to understand it in different regularization schemes and understand what we mean by the running coupling, but I'm not going to talk about it more because I want to talk a little bit more about collider physics. I hope that's okay. But I'll take questions if you have them. I assume it's kind of review. Okay. No, I'll do this myself. Okay, yeah. How did you, well, so it's defined this way. Here I'm solving this equation. So this is a differential equation. This is a solution to the differential equation where this is the integration constant, right? And then I'm using the boundary condition that we just talked about. So alpha at, say, 92 GeV is 0.11, right? So I choose mu equals 90 GeV. Alpha equals 0.1, and that lets me determine what lambda is, right? And you get lambda is 100 MeV, right? So this is the equivalent way of saying saying lambda QCD is 100 MeV is equivalent to saying alpha at 92 GeV is 0.1, right? And so you just plug this in. So equivalently, I could just solve this equation here. It's just a differential equation. I run it down. I solve the equation starting with a boundary condition here, and I find out that so I start at say this is Q. Here's 0.1, and then as I go down in Q, it starts increasing, and eventually here when I take mu equals lambda QCD, this is log of 1, which is 0, I get 1 over 0, which is infinity. So it kind of blows up at lambda QCD. But this is the formal solution to this differential equation, and I'm just changing a UV boundary condition for an IR boundary condition. It's exactly the same. So there's different ways to define lambda QCD. This way of defining it is just a parameter in the running alpha, right? But of course, you don't trust perturbation theory. This is the leading order calculation, and there's corrections to this. You know, alpha cubed plus alpha to the fourth. And as long as alpha is small, you don't need those corrections. But by the time alpha gets to be of order 1, you start to need them, right? So you shouldn't expect to use this form for alpha when mu is down near lambda QCD. It's just a form for the function that's valid at higher values. But it gives you a rough idea of what lambda is, right? So this is a well-defined quantity as long as this is perturbative. But it's not that you would trust the value of the coupling close to lambda QCD. Right? And there's other ways to define lambda QCD. You can define it on the lattice as the lattice spacing that you're using. You can define it in the chiral perturbation theory as some non-perturbative scale associated with the size of the pion. And you have to know what scheme you're talking about when you're talking about lambda QCD. But they all come out a couple of hundred MeV. Right? So all you can conclude from this is that at some scale around a couple of hundred MeV, you don't trust perturbation theory anymore. Right? That's all you can trust about low energy physics. However, this is a well-defined quantity in perturbation theory that you can calculate order by order. As long as you don't trust the form of the function down there, you can still talk about this. We call this dimensional transmutation, trading a dimensionless number for a dimensionful number. But it's not really that you just have a dimensionless number here. You really have a scale also. So it's a little artificial to say you're changing something. Other questions? Right, and the you know, the physical picture of confinement is that because the coupling constant gets strong at large distances, you can't ever separate quarks. And the way to see that is, you know, we talked about these bound states, so we have this, you know, singlet UU bar state, which is really UU bar plus DD bar. I mean, let's just say we have one quark. So it's UU bar, and it's a color singlet combination. So when the U's are close together, we're at very high energy, and the theory is weak. But as I start to separate them farther apart, it takes more and more energy. So I can just ask, suppose I just, you know, try to pull this out. I just grab it with a little pair of tweezers and try to pull it away. And I can ask, how much energy will it take to pull it a certain distance? And when they're very close together and the force is very weak, it's easy to pull it. They're essentially free and I can move it around as much as I want. But as it gets farther apart, the force that's holding them together becomes stronger and stronger. It's like a magnet that, instead of getting weaker at large distances, becomes stronger and stronger. So it takes more and more energy to pull it apart. And eventually, when I pull it apart very, very far, of order, you know, 100 MeV, which is around an inverse femtometer, it takes so much energy to pull them apart that it's more energetically favorable for to form out of the vacuum an up bar and up state. And I get something like that, and then this springs back into a bound state here, and I get another state here. So I start with one pion, and I try to pull the anti-quark out of the pion, and eventually it takes so much energy that I nucleate a new pion from the vacuum. And then this pulls back here, and I'm just pulling my anti-quark away along with a quark that I produced, right? So when this scale becomes of order lambda QCD, so when it takes 100 MeV of energy to pull them apart, it's more energetically favorable to produce new pions and then lets me separate them. And this is qualitatively why you can't have free quarks, because when you try to free them, you just produce new particles, and then they stay bound, right? You just snap your, you think of it also like a string or a rubber band. And as you, you know, a rubber band is kind of loose if you don't stretch it. And then as you start to stretch it, it takes enough energy that eventually you snap it, and then you get two new ends of rubber bands, right? So you can't ever have a free end of a rubber band because you always have two ends. And moreover, you can't ever have the ends separated by more than, you know, it becomes stiff at a certain point. Maybe you've heard this before. But it's a nice qualitative way to see why the running coupling implies that you can't have free quarks. And I should say everyone believes this, but no one's ever proven it to be true. You know, proving quarks are always confined is an open problem in QCD. But it seems to make sense, and it agrees with data. Okay. Right. Okay, I want to start talking next about the scattering, connecting QCD to collider physics. So collider physics goes back a long time, and I like to think of the first collider physics experiment was Rutherford's experiments. You know, more than 100 years ago now. So what Rutherford did is he had a radioactive source, radon. And radon emits alpha particles, which is a helium nucleus, of 8 MeV. So back in 1910, they didn't have particle accelerators, but they had nature's particle accelerators, which, you know, we didn't have that many types, but they had radioactive elements which decayed, and this produced an alpha particle. So he was rather limited in the types of energies he had, but 8 MeV is a lot, actually. It took a while for accelerators should be able to produce 8 MeV. So he would have these alpha particles go, and he would kind of collimate them through a little beam, and he would shine them on a piece of gold foil, so a thin sheet of foil, and see what happened. Now, these are very energetic. So 8 MeV is a lot of energy, right? And this is a very thin piece of foil. So what would happen is mostly they would just plow through this. You would think of them like bullets shooting through a piece of tissue paper, was the analogy between this thin sheet and these hugely energetic alpha particles. So most of the time they would go through. Sometimes they would deflect a little. But every once in a while, one would bounce right backwards. Right? And this is very strange. And you can imagine shooting a bullet through a piece of tissue paper and having the bullet bounce back at you. It would be a very strange occurrence. And this is kind of what he was seeing. And this is, of course, first evidence of the existence of the nucleus. And what Rutherford did is he wanted to know if you can, from the angle of the deflected alpha particle, to do something about the size of the nucleus. And of course, he didn't have quantum mechanics back then. He just had classical mechanics. That's really all you need. So you have a positively charged particle, a positively charged nucleus, and you can parameterize it in terms of this impact parameter and the scattering angle. So just assuming a Coulomb potential, you can calculate the relation between the impact parameter and the scattering angle, which is 1 over 2 pi z e squared over mv squared, which is the kinetic energy, times cotangent of theta over 2. So if you know the impact parameter, you know the scattering angle, if you assume it's a Coulomb potential. So you're assuming some initial distribution that's basically you flat an impact parameter, and from that you can deduce the differential cross-section in the scattering angle. And just plugging in, Rutherford got e squared over 4 pi mv squared. So this is the differential cross-section, which you can also calculate in quantum field theory from this T-channel exchange. Maybe we'll do that in a minute. So Rutherford calculated this, and he measured the deflection, and he saw that it was perfectly consistent with this formula. And what he was trying to do is figure out from this the size of the nucleus. So he expected if the nucleus had some finite size, eventually you would just hit it, and he would be able to see a deviation from this. But really what would happen is that the alpha particles, so here's the nucleus, and here's an alpha particle coming in at zero impact parameter. In order to see the deflection, in order to see the size of the nucleus, it has to hit the nucleus. But unfortunately, because the Coulomb potential is so strong, right, the Coulomb potential goes like 1 over r. And so as you get closer and closer to energy, and if you're at zero impact parameter with a finite amount of energy, there's only a finite distance you can get to within the nucleus. In fact, it's not hard to figure out how close you can approach the nucleus. We know the initial energy is 1/2 mv squared. And if you set this equal to the Coulomb energy, which is z e squared over 4 pi r max, right? That is, it can only get to a distance where all the kinetic energy becomes potential energy, and then it'll hit the potential barrier and fall and roll back out. So he was trying to figure out how close he was getting with the zero impact parameter scattering. What he got was R max is 4.8 times 10 to the minus 15 meters. So 4.8 femtometers. So he was basically able to show that the proton was smaller than 5 femtometers from this alpha particle scattering, which is actually pretty good, right? I mean, it's not that much smaller than 5 femtometers. I should say also, because this Coulomb energy goes like z, right, you actually want to scatter off of nuclei with smaller z so you can get to smaller r, right? So, you know, his gold foil experiment was famous, but really this best bound came from aluminum foil because aluminum is z equals 13 and gold is z equals 79. So gold because E equals 79, and which is 79 is good if you want to have a large deflection, but aluminum as E equals 13 is better if you want to figure out the size of the proton. And of course, ideally, you'd want Z equals 1 proton. Z equals 1, which is how what the kind of next stage in these collider experiments were. But Rutherford's experiment was very impressive because he gave a rough, you know, an order of magnitude correct estimate of the size of the proton simply from scattering with stuff he had around the lab in 1909. Okay, so what happened next is it took quite a while for people to be able to control the energy of the incoming particle scattering. And what we'd like to be able to do is scatter off of protons as E equals 1 with the hope of probing the structure of the proton from these kind of scattering. Instead of scattering alpha particles, they would scatter electrons. So the classic experiments to probe the structure of the proton was called electron-proton scattering. So here we have, in field theory, an electron coming in and a proton. And you can calculate d sigma d omega, the scattering angle, in the lab prim is alpha over 4 e squared sine to the 4th theta over 2 times cosine squared theta over 2 minus q squared over 2 times the mass of the proton. So this is what you just get in tree level QED for the scattering process. Here q is the momentum transfer. So we say this as incoming momentum k and scattered momentum k prime. So momentum transfer is the difference between the incoming electron's momentum and the scattering electron's momentum. In the same way, he was just scattering the alpha particle, and he knew the incoming momentum, and he measured the outgoing momentum. This is the generalization of that. I should point out that Rutherford's experiment was around 1910. These experiments were done in the 1950s, so it was a long time before people could actually scatter and control the energy of the incoming electrons. These early experiments were done on hydrogen gas, so these protons were just a gas of hydrogen, in which case, because it's a gas, you don't know you don't know where the protons are, but you also can't measure properties of the protons. But you do know the electron beams. You just shoot a beam of electrons into a gas and measure where the electrons are scattered. So you know the incoming electron momentum and the outgoing electron momentum, but you don't know anything about the outgoing proton. You don't know if the proton stays intact. You don't know if it breaks apart. You're not measuring anything about the proton. And therefore, it's important to measure in this cross-section to only be using features of the electron, right? So the way we've expressed it, it only depends on the momentum transfer, which is defined as the difference between the incoming and outgoing electron momentum and nothing having to do with the proton momentum. It wasn't actually till the 1970s. A lot of these early deep inelastic scattering experiments or electron-positron experiments were done in Stanford and SLAC in the United States. It wasn't really till the 1970s that people could measure the outgoing state of the proton. Keep in mind, these weren't, you know, our modern detectors cover all of space. They're what we call 4-pi detectors, and they essentially measure everything. But the early detectors were, they would have a detector that they would move around. So they would just see, they want to find out how many electrons you get over here, so they would have a detector here, and they would just wait. They would shine a beam in and see how many hits they get, and then move the detector over there and see how many hits they get. And they certainly wouldn't be measuring everything. They would just be measuring how many electrons get to that point. So it took a while before people could measure everything to figure out the proton final state and so on. And that wasn't until the 70s and then into the 80s with UA1 at CERN, where they had really 4-pi detectors. So this is the parameterization. This is similar to Rutherford's cross-section, except for these business, which has to do with the spin of the proton, because they're fermions, which, of course, Rutherford didn't know anything about fermions, so he just treated everything as scalars, which is a good first approximation, and then you get this extra dependence because of the finite mass of the proton and so on. So this was a good agreement with the early electron-positron scattering experiments. But of course, to calculate this, you're assuming that the proton is a point, and doesn't have any structure to it. So you'd like to have, in order to be able to see structure, you want a parameterization that allows for deviations from this formula. So what you can do is, where's the electron? So we say we don't know what the proton is made of. So we're just going to call the interactions between the proton and the photon. So there's, again, incoming momentum transfer Q. We write this as a form factor. So let's call this gamma mu. So mu is the index that contracts with the photon polarization. And you can write it very generally as F1 of Q squared gamma mu I sigma mu nu over MP Q nu. Sigma mu nu are the spin structure associated with the magnetic dipole moment of the proton. So this is just a general parameterization we can have for the interaction of a fermion with a photon. So if you plug this in and redo this calculation, so to get this formula, we assume that gamma mu nu is just little gamma mu nu, as it is in perturbation theory. That is, F1, well, the boundary conditions are F1 of 0 equals 1 and F2 of 0 equals 0, that at large distances it reduces to just the QED interaction. But then the hope is that at large momentum transfers, we start to see deviations from this. So you plug this in, and you figure out d sigma d omega in terms of these form factors is 4 sine to the 4 theta over 2. These E is the electron momentum times F1 squared cosine squared theta over 2 minus Q squared over 2 MP squared F2 so what you get is a generalization of this formula. So if I take F0 equals 1 and F2 equals 0, I get cosine theta plus minus this thing. So I get exactly this formula. So this is the tree-level version of this. But this allows for more general things, and I don't know what F1 and F2 are. So the idea is to allow for them to be very general, measure them in data, and hope for some agreement with some theory that we didn't know yet at the time. Maybe it's QCD, maybe not. But in particular, if we do these experiments at very high energy, much greater than the proton mass, we would like to know what these form factors can depend on. I should say this is called the Rosenbluth formula. Move a box around it. Rosenbluth formula. So experimentally, they found that F1 of Q squared is approximately 1 over 1 minus GeV squared. So this is sort of surprising, because what it tells you is there's some scale here, right? If you just scatter electrons off of protons, so for example, if I scattered electrons off of muons, I could do the same thing and go to write the same Rosenbluth parameterization and go to arbitrarily high energy, and I would never find this other scale, right? If my energy is much higher than the electron and muon mass, that's generally negligible, and the whole thing is just point-like. So you wouldn't get F1 of Q squared is this, you would get some number, just a constant. Maybe logarithmic dependence on Q squared from some running coupling effects, but this would be very small in QED. So this is a very different result. This is saying that somehow the proton structure is very different from the structure of an electron or a muon, in that there's some scale that appears in this form factor. And to understand this, so this may be a funny way of writing the square of a propagator. I can write this as 1 over, Q squared minus M squared, where I just pull out a constant. So this is just some constant. And this tells you that this looks like the scattering. So what is this? This is the propagator for a massive particle. So this is a particle of mass M, which is around 0.7 GeV or 700 MeV. And this is what you would get for the form factor from a diagram where I would have the exchange of a particle of, it's really something being exchanged within the proton. That looks like it has mass M. This thing, if I Fourier transform it, I get a potential that's just the normal Yukawa potential with a characteristic size with M is 0.7 GeV. So roughly what we're seeing is this corresponds to the Yukawa potential generated from pion exchange. And pion, order of magnitude is a few hundred MeV. And so we're seeing the evidence for this Yukawa structure within the structure of the proton. In particular, we're seeing this exponential shape. That is, you're scattering, so think of it like here's a proton and here's an electron coming in. There's a characteristic size associated with the proton for which the scattering amplitude differs from point-like scattering. You're starting to see substructure of a proton at a characteristic size of order around a femtometer. So this is first evidence that the proton has structure. This was in the early 1970s of the Mark experiment at SLAC. This is very famous. There were Nobel Prizes awarded for this result. And again, these were for scattering, of order GeV. So what happened next is that we wanted to go to higher energy. So at higher energy, this form factor parameterization doesn't apply. This form factor parameterization assumes that the incoming state and outgoing state are protons. That is, it's elastic scattering. But at higher energy, we could have a photon come in, a proton come in, and the proton can break apart. So this is for elastic. If it can be inelastic scattering, where the proton breaks apart, and then parameterization doesn't apply, but we could write a different parameterization, dE prime, in terms of form factors. So this is the parameterization that's used, and I have to explain what X is. So again, we have an electron coming in with momentum transfer Q. So we still just measure the incoming and outgoing electron momentum. So we still just know the momentum transfer. Of course, we know the proton's initial momentum, P. And we want to have our form factors only depend on these quantities. And we want to have Lorentz invariant parameterization. So if we're not assuming that the outgoing state is all a proton, we have K and K prime and P to work with. So I should say, first of all, because it's a T-channel exchange, Q squared is less than zero. So we define capital Q is the square root of minus Q squared, which is greater than zero. So Q is a four vector. Q mu is K minus K prime mu. So this is the four vector squared, which is the invariant mass of a space-like four vector. But this is just a number. So capital Q is a number, and little q is a four vector. So that's one Lorentz invariant quantity that characterizes it. We know, so we have only q and p to work with. So we have q squared, that's one of them. We have p squared, which is just the proton mass squared, which is going to be zero, except for that 1 over mp there, and that mp. But generally, we're going to neglect proton mass effects when we go to high energy. So the only other dimensionless Lorentz invariant quantity we can write down is q dot p. And we define the dimensionless quantity x as q squared over 2 p dot q. All right, this is known as Bjorken x. So again, all we're doing is measuring the incoming and outgoing electron. We have a proton gas essentially at rest. So we know what x is from the outgoing electron momentum. Right. Okay, so what does measuring x tell us? So I don't need this anymore. So we can go ahead and measure W1 and W2, but we don't know what to compare to, because the proton's going to start breaking apart when we have inelastic scattering, and we want to have some model that we can compare to it. And so the model that works great is called the parton model, and it's originally due to Richard Feynman. And the parton model says that this scattering, we think of the proton as the electron is scattering off of essentially free particles within the proton. And the probability of scattering off a parton depends on the momentum. So we say, so this is momentum P, and let's call this PI. So there's some parton which has some fraction of the proton's momentum. And it scatters into a final state particle, right? So the idea is that even though the scattering of the proton is inelastic, it's actually described by the inelastic business comes from the leftover parts of the proton scattering, and maybe this final state could be, it doesn't have to be a single quark, it could be something else, or a single parton. But there's also all the other stuff in the proton that has to do with it breaking apart. Right. So to the extent that it scatters into a single final state particle, we have p, the initial quark momentum or parton momentum squared is equal to the final momentum squared. And so this says that the quark mass squared plus 2 pi dot q plus q squared equals the quark mass squared. So we can cancel that off of both sides. And that says that q squared over 2 pi dot q equals 1. Right? So that's the parton version of x equals 1. So if we say the parton has some fraction psi of the proton momentum, then I plug in, so this thing equals q squared over 2 psi p dot q, which is, so there's x is q squared over p dot q, so this is x over psi. And therefore, x equals psi. Right, so that tells us that within the parton model, by measuring x, the distribution, these functions, the function of x and q, if I know x, what I know is the fraction of the proton momentum in a parton. right? So the idea is that even though the proton has substructure, our quark can be scattering off of individual, the electron can be scattering off of individual partons within the quark that don't themselves have substructure. And so that can be a scattering described by perturbation theory, which is a leading order given by the Rosenbluth formula again, or more simply by Rutherford scattering. So that's a prediction of the parton model. In other words, that all of that, all of the structure in that 700 MeV scale had to do with the structure of the proton itself. But then once you start scattering off of partons, these are fundamental point-like particles again. In other words, we say that the cross-section is given by the sum of the particles, d psi fi of psi, times the cross-section for... So the parton model says we can calculate this thing here, the scattering from the proton by scattering off of individual partons by calculating the cross-section and perturbation theory. And in particular, there's no scale involved in this, right? While the proton has substructure, there's relevance as the proton mass, and there's the substructure for the soup within the proton. When I scatter off the partons, there's no longer any substructure. So I shouldn't have any dimensionful scales here, and this should be something that's essentially scaleless, right? And what that means is that I've written these form factors as a function of x and q. And q is a dimensionful thing, but I've written it in terms of a dimensionless quantity x. So it says that the structure function should only depend on x and not separately on q. They shouldn't have any, because if it depended on q, they would have to have another scale, right? If wi of x might look like, I don't know, 1 minus x squared or something, which is dimensionless, but if it depends on q, it has to be, log q over some scale. Right? And the parton model says we're scattering off of point-like quarks, and so there's no other scale around. Everything is massless. So it can't depend on Q at all. Right? So this is a prediction of the parton model that these structure functions should depend only on X and not on Q. Right? And that's called Bjorken scaling. So Bjorken... W depends on X and not Q. I have some plots about this. Let me see if let's look at this. So here's this is early deep inelastic scattering, inelastic proton scattering data. So this is this form factor W2 as a function of Q squared, and you can see very well that it doesn't depend on Q squared at fixed values of x. And this is some, they're telling you the different angles that things have scattered at. So different angles give you different values of x, but it's there's an x dependence, but they don't depend on Q squared at all. Here is better data. So this is, this is early data from the 1970s. This is data from Hera, which ran throughout the 90s in Hamburg. And this is very, very precise high-energy data. And so this is a function of Q squared over here, and each of these lines is a different value of x. So you can see for each value, of x, it's roughly Q squared independent. But if I go from here to here, you see that the slope of these lines slightly changes. Right? So what we're seeing is not only this Bjorken scaling, that is each of these lines is flat and is a function of Q squared at fixed x, but also that there's some small, there is some small Q squared dependence, which is actually, we now understand from the normalization group effects from the running of the PTF. So this is scaling violation, but it's a logarithmic scaling violation with Q that we can calculate from the normalization group dependence of the parton distribution functions, which I'll discuss next. But qualitatively, what you should think is that so at low energy, scattering of protons and electrons is elastic. There's no evidence for structure. This is what Rutherford saw. It's essentially a point-like particle. When you go to higher energies, it starts breaking apart. But then you go to very high energies, it becomes point-like again. You're scattering off of point-like constituents within the proton. So all of the non-point-like part of it is contained in these parton distribution functions. So the parton distribution functions are they're roughly scale independent, although here I'm going by two orders of magnitude and scale. So what's shown on the left, these are x times the parton distribution function, and I'll explain the x in a second. Let me just leave these up and write some equations on the board. So there's a couple of things we know about the parton distribution functions from just their probabilistic interpretation. If we're assuming this is the probability of finding a quark with a certain momentum fraction, and we know that the quark number is conserved. So in QCD, the number of up quarks is conserved, or up minus anti-up, the number of down quarks is conserved, and so on. So this tells us that the probability of finding an up quark minus the probability of finding an anti-up quark has to be 2, because there's 2 up quarks total in a proton. Similarly, the probability of finding a down quark equals 1, and the probability of finding anything else, like a strange quark, S bar equals 0. So you can see in the parton distribution functions here. So this is up, down. Here's gluon. We'll talk about that in a second. And here's anti-up. Anti-up is very small. So the you can see the up quark is roughly twice the down quark. And that's because there's twice as many up quarks as down quarks. So this is a probability of finding an up quark is twice as great as probability of finding a down quark. You can see that this is it peaks around 0.2, so roughly a third of the, a fifth here, but something like a third of the momentum of proton is in each individual parton. So the down and the up both peak around the same place, which is roughly the fraction of the proton's momentum that's in the up and down. The other sum rule is the sum over all partons of integral psi times fj of psi equals 1. So this is called the momentum sum rule. It's not that hard to derive, and certainly classically, it actually follows. So all of these can be derived rigorously in quantum field theory from symmetries. So this is the up quark number conservation in QCD. This one corresponds to momentum conservation. And the way to see that is if I look at the expected value of the total momentum in up quarks, this is given by integral d psi of the momentum. The up quark momentum is psi times the proton momentum times fq psi. And you can do the same thing for other types of quarks. On the other hand, the expected value of the total proton momentum is just p mu. And so then it should be the sum of all these guys, which is d psi psi. I can pull p mu out front. Fi of psi. And the p mu's are the same on both sides, and so you just see that the expected value of the proton momentum is the same as the sum of the expected value of the momentum of all the individual partons. And that's where this sum comes from. Essentially momentum conservation. And that's why psi times f is a better quantity for plotting than just f itself, because this tells you this is the thing that's normalized, so they sum to 1. And so if you look, that's what's being plotted there. So the integral over all these curves over x sums to 1. And so it roughly tells you the momentum fraction in ups, downs, and gluons. And in particular, what you can do is calculate, now we know what the PDFs are. So you know what the up, if you ask what fraction of the proton's momentum is in ups and down quarks, so that is, we calculate the integral d psi f up of psi plus f down of psi. It turns out this is around 0.38. In other words, only 38% of the proton's momentum is contained in these what are called valence quarks, the up and down quarks. And the rest of it is contained, well, you can see there's a large amount of gluons in there, and there's also anti-ups and stranges and so on. And of course, this depends on energy. Right? At very, very high energy, when we're at Q squared of a TeV or 10 TeV, then there's really no difference between up and down and the valence quarks, and the C quarks is what we call everything that's not valence. So valence quarks refers to the up and the down, and C quarks refer to anti-up or anti-down or strange or, and then we talk about gluon separately. So at very high energy, these PDFs all become the same, and you can sort of see that here. So this is a 2 GeV, and then if you go to very high energy, these all start to look like each other, and they become roughly evenly distributed. So while there's 38% of the momentum of proton and up and down here, at very high energy, there's going to be a lot less. It's going to be evenly distributed among the ups and the downs and the anti-ups and anti-downs and gluons and so on. So these parton distribution functions, so this parton model works really, really well. And there's an extent to which you can justify it in QCD, which I should have time to talk about a little. But first, I just want to give you a kind of a qualitative sense of how to think about PDFs and what we know about them. So let me show a few slides on that before going back to the board. First, are there any questions about this, about just sort of the calculations and how to think about deep inelastic scattering? A little bit. Okay, we'll think about it. So the PDFs come with uncertainties. Maybe I should show this first. So these are roughly the uncertainties under some of the... There's a bunch of different PDF sets that you get. So... I don't have that plot. No, I didn't put it here. I don't have it. No. I thought I had another slide. Okay, let's just look at these then. Here's one that compares the different PDFs. Let me go back to this. Okay, so this roughly tells you the uncertainties on the PDFs, and you see that the gluon PDF has a lot of uncertainty, and all of these have a fair amount of uncertainty under small x. There's kind of a limit to how small x you can get. Remember, x is the fraction of the proton's momentum in a quark. And really, you can't have a quark with less than roughly lambda QCD. So if you're at, doing collisions at 100 GeV, then x can't be less than, 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3. And so there's a lot of uncertainty into these because we can't directly probe them, and you have to do kind of extrapolations using fits. Yeah, please. All these come from experiment, yeah. Well, not exactly. So what we know from perturbative QCD, we don't know, the PDFs are completely non-perturbative objects, but their scale dependence is calculable. And that's given by these evolution equations. So there's a, I'll derive this in a second, but we have this x of q. Well, let me write it as q. We have an equation for this, which is some integral equation of d psi f of x over psi. Write it down properly. Q times P Q of X over Xi, where this PQQ is CF of Z 1 plus Z squared over 1 minus Z plus 3/2. So something like this. Now we'll come back to the, well, maybe not. But there's some evolution equation. So what perturbative QCD tells you is if I know the PDFs at one scale Q, I can calculate them at another scale Q. But it doesn't, and that calculation involves this integral over the values of the PDF. So if I want to know it at, say, 0.1, I have to integrate this from 0 to x of p. So this p, this factor is limited. It should be a probability. I'm sorry, it's x to 1. So I integrate over values of f at, if I want to know f at, say, 0.1, it involves an integral from 0.1 to 1 of those f's, right? So if I want to go from, so usually we draw things like this where I'll have q squared and x. And usually we plot these on a log axis. So if I want to know, if I know the PDFs over here at some x and some q squared, I can evolve, I know what they are at a higher values of q at the same x. So the, I'll come back to that in a second. So this is called let me just write the abbreviation, DGLAP evolution. DGLAP stands for Dockchester, Gribov, Lipotov, Altarelli, and Parisi. And these are sometimes called Altarelli-Parisi splitting functions. So what this equation tells you is if I know the PDFs at some scale q squared, for x greater than something, I can evolve up. So I can evolve to higher values of q squared from just solving that equation. But I can't ever use this equation to get to lower values of x. So I have to know what it is over here in order to go up, and I can't get to higher q squared at lower values of x either. So you have to directly measure at low x in order to know what the PDFs are. There's some theory that tells you the evolution towards small x called, talk about it. There's some, basically we don't know how to evolve the PDFs to small x, but we can evolve them in q squared. Moreover, for a given collider, we're sort of limited by, so there's the quantity, if I calculate q squared over x times the center of mass energy, you can also show that this is given by the fractional of the energy of the scattered electron, which is generally less than 1. And what this tells you is that q squared is less than x times the center of mass energy. In other words, X is great. There's a minimum if a given S. So a given machine, so LHC has S is, so let me write this way. X is greater than Q squared over S. So LHC has 13 TeV. That means that for a given Q squared, X is greater than a certain value. So we draw these kind of triangles here in the XQ plane, having to do with different machines. So this would be the LHC, and this is the Tevatron. And this would be Hera, which is some deep inelastic scattering machine. And so the machines are directly sensitive to anything in that triangle. So if you have a given machine, I can measure the PDFs at x's and q squareds in this region, and the DGLAP evolution helps you evolve upwards. But to get to smaller x, you really need to go to higher energy, which is not unintuitive because, you know, if I want to measure a 1 GeV particle, it's a, you know, a thousandth of the energy of a 1 TeV collision, but only a hundredth of a 100 GeV machine. So x is 0.01 at the, you know, might be a 0.01 at the Tevatron, but 0.001 at the LHC. So you get to smaller x when you go to higher energy, and we need those to measurements. Of course, you don't need smaller x if you're at lower energy. But it's interesting theoretically. So the way the PDFs are fit, they're basically done with global fits. And they usually use a parameterization. So a typical parameterization is f of x q squared is ai x to the little ai 1 plus bi square root of x plus ci x times 1 minus x to the di. Right, so there's these five numbers, ai, capital AI, little ai, bi, ci, and di. So you choose this parameterization, one for quarks, for valence quarks, for C quarks, for anti-quarks, gluons, and so on, and you fit these numbers, and you use the Dglap evolution to go to different Q squared. So you do some measurement, which is sensitive to the PDFs at some values of X and Q squared, and you do a global fit of all the data that you have to these values, and then you tabulate them, and then you provide code that people can use it to evolve to different scales. And there's a lot of different PDF fits out there. There's CTEC and MSTW and MRST, and there's something called the NeuralNet PDFs, which actually doesn't use this parameterization. They do a kind of more unconstrained fit using multivariate techniques. So let me just show some slides here. Right, so this is what I showed before, showing some of the uncertainty at small x. And again, that uncertainty is due to our, you know, we need higher energy machines to measure small x. But keep in mind that because you need a higher energy machine to measure small x, it's actually rare that the very small x PDFs contribute. That's what we're seeing here. And I should also say they don't fit everything separately. A lot of times these heavy quark PDFs are determined from the gluon PDF because the only way you can get a heavy quark is from a gluon splitting into, say, a CC bar pair. So often these aren't fit independently, but they're constrained by the gluon PDF. But there are a fair amount of differences. So here's a comparison of the luminosities. So remember, we talked about luminosities before. Luminosities are integrals of the PDFs. So luminosity as a function of S hat is usually defined by dx1, dx2, f of x1, f of x2, times delta of x1, x2, s minus s hat. So they're here, they're choosing s, this is capital S to be ATV, and then they're plotting it as a function of s hat. So this is a convolution of the two different PDFs. And it's a physical thing that tells you what the cross section is going to be for, say, S channel production. So each band here is the uncertainty. It's normalized to MSTW, which is kind of the standard that people always normalize things to. And you can see there is, again, there's a fair amount of uncertainty at very large square root of S because that hasn't been directly probed. There's uncertainty at a small scale because small x corresponds to small s hat. And there's uncertainty there. But you see that, you know, maybe they roughly agree. But of course, in some regions, there's a fair amount of difference. You see, particularly over here, there can be a lot of difference between some of these PDFs. And so your cross sections can have, although keep in mind, this is, 10% difference. It goes 0.9, but 10% can be a lot, and the dominant source of uncertainty in a lot of calculations, especially at high energy, is due to uncertainties on the PDFs. Here's another comparison of MSTW and CTEC for the quarks and gluons. What do I want to say about these? I don't know. Are there questions about these PDFs? Let me go back to the other ones. I think that was maybe the most informative. Question? No. No, it's not perturbative. It's non-perturbative. This is from data. The uncertainty bands have to do with, so where does the uncertainty come from? They use different PDF sets to do the fits. I mean, the different sets of data, and there's experimental uncertainty in the data, which feeds into this. And the way the uncertainty is, so I should say, until maybe 5 years ago, PDFs didn't come with uncertainties. So this is a kind of a rather modern development. So the uncertainties come from experimental uncertainties on the things that have been measured. It's not so much due to perturbative uncertainties. These splitting functions, this is just the leading order, so one loop, but it's actually known to three loops. And that's all used in the evolution. They talk about leading order PDFs, next leading order, next to next leading order, which to some extent has to do with what order the evolution is used, but it also has to do with what order the theory calculation is being used that converts the PDFs to compared to the data. So, for example, if you measure Drellians, you measure the production of a muon pair at the Tevatron. This is one thing that's sensitive directly to this luminosity function, and then you measure as a function of S hat. But in order to predict the cross-section, you have to convolve that with your perturbative calculation of what the cross-section is, which is known to around two loops for Drellian. And so you would use that to fit an next leading order PDF. But if you also want to use DiJet data, right, which is only known to one loop, then you can't really get an next leading order PDF. So there's some, it's not exactly well-defined what order they are, because they want to use all available data, but sometimes the theory calculation isn't known as accurately. So they feed all of that theory uncertainty and also to these uncertainty bands. You also have to be careful. If you're doing a theory calculation of leading order, you really should be using leading order PDFs, because otherwise you'll be using some things at higher order and some things at lower order. And there's somewhat of an art to doing it. Mostly what people do to estimate uncertainties is using these bands, but also comparing different PDF sets, and that can give you a sense of the uncertainties. So the PDF sets now come with around 40 different independent variations, which are supposed to account for the various uncertainties associated with different orders they do matching and different data sets they use. There's also uncertainties associated with the parameterization. If you use a different parameterization, you might get slightly different fits, so there's uncertainties associated with that. And that's why there's differences, because they're fitting to, there's global sets of data, but people choose to use some. They believe that some are better quality data than others. They believe that certain parameterizations are better. They believed, if you're doing next to next leading order, you should only include this and not that, because we only know this to certain accuracy. So there's some kind of a political aspect. Some of it's historical. There's different groups. They're not great, but they're improving, and they all kind of improve together as we get more data. And the thing we're learning from the LHC is getting mostly the high Q and low X data, which you didn't have access to in other places. So we should be able to reduce these kind of uncertainties at the LHC, and also very large X, which you can also get at these machines. Other questions? So I don't know. I mean, I have tons more things I could say. I was going to, to derive. So this is all assuming the Parton model works, right? Assuming there exist these classical probabilities. You can't rigorously prove that within quantum field theory, but you can show that it's sort of self-consistent within quantum field theory. It would probably take an hour or so to do that calculation, which I don't have time for, but it's also kind of technical. Let me see if there's anything I can say about it without doing the full calculation. Well, I mean, what I want to say, nobody has ever proven that you can use PDFs rigorously in quantum field theory. In particular, what people haven't proven is that the same PDFs apply to different processes, right? We'd like to say, so factorization is a statement that you can calculate something by saying there's this kind of initial interaction involving PDFs, and then there's some hard scattering, and then there's something that happens in the final state. We use that assumption everywhere, but it hasn't been rigorously proven. It hasn't been proven that the same PDFs apply to all processes, and that the two PDFs for the two protons are independent. In fact, we know that they're not. That there's factorizing violating interactions that occur to nearly everything. A lot of this has to do with what's called the underlying event, which is the way the spectator proton. So the Parton model essentially assumes that you can scatter the quark out of the proton and ignore everything else. And that's not really true. In fact, sometimes it can be a very big effect, but mostly it seems to work. And so instead, what you show rigorously is, assuming the part-time model, how do you calculate things like the evolution of these PDFs within perturbative QCD? How do you, even assuming that it works, you still have to have a precise definition of what you mean by it. Some, you know, within the context of renormalization, you have to have a renormalization condition for the PDFs, which you can do by defining it in terms of those structure functions W that I indicated before. That lends you, so there's different, you know, short distance definitions of the PDFs depending on how you identify them with structure functions. So I don't know. There's rather long calculations you can do to illustrate some of these statements, but I don't have time for them now. They're in my book, so if you want to read in more detail, I encourage you to look there. They're also discussed to some extent in the pink book, which you can go for more information. But maybe that's too technical anyway, so this is a good place to stop. Are we out of time? Yes. They're quiet. Okay, we'll stop here.